here, so don't worry about that. You won't be a YouTube star today.
Okay.
All right. So let's get moving here. And actually, before I forget, yes, Lindsay, thanks for bringing that up.
After every class, we have a few giveaways that we hand out. We have 2 gift bags today. I wish we could have more, but we've exhausted our stock of goodie bags for the year. We need to replenish around the holiday season. So we've got 2 gift bags with a few assorted items that we hand out. All you need to do is just put an entry into the raffle for that, and Lindsay will come around. If you want to be a part of that, you can definitely take an entry ticket and get yourself in. There's no purchase price. It's completely free. It's just for being here. We'll be drawing 2 names at random from everyone that puts their name in the bucket. Okay? Pretty unanimous. Ruth to the rescue. Oh, thank you. Great. Okay. So Ruth is handing out agendas. Do you have cheat sheets as well?
Yeah.
Ruth,
okay.
Those are coming. Okay. Perfect. That's fine. So the agenda is a front-back document. There's enough room, hopefully, for some notes on there. I packed a lot of content in on here, and again, we may not get to cover every single thing in detail, but I do want to get to all the important aspects, the things that make Windows 8 Windows 8, of course. Because I presume that most of you have already used the older versions of Windows. We're not going to spend that much time in the desktop environment because that's been around for some time now, and that's fairly familiar to all of us. I've split everything up into the sections that we're going to be covering things. Part 1, part 2, a little bit on the OneDrive integration that's within Windows 8, a little bit on the traditional desktop, some of the new features there. And then at the end, there's a resource list for places you can go to get more information about how do I use Windows 8? And actually, one that I did not put on here, Ruth, correct me if I'm wrong, Niles Library now has a subscription to lynda.com.
Yes.
Lynda.com is probably one of the foremost and greatest online video learning, what do you call it? The learning encyclopedias in terms of software knowledge. And you can go on and see in depth a lot of the topics that we're going to breeze over today. They're going to go into in depth, long videos. And that's a full subscription that we have to Niles Library. So,
subscription. If you're accessing
Lynda.com is great. DePaul, where I go to school, I've got a subscription to Lynda.com. I use it from time to time to learn up on items and technology things. So if you think this class is a great introduction to Windows 8, if you're looking to learn more, Lynda.com is probably going to be your best bet for taking it to the next level, as opposed to doing some kind of community college course or something like that. You learn at your own pace, full HD video of every single area that you may be interested in. And the nice part is they divide it by section, topical area, so you can just dive into the things that you're interested in and don't know about. So before I get too far, I want to introduce who I am, who we are, and some of my staff that I have with me here today. This is one of the largest classes we have this year, next to our security class that we did, and you know those are two of our most popular offerings that we have. But my name is Derrick Wlodarz. I founded a local small IT consulting company, computer repair company. We primarily specialize in commercial, nonprofit education, consulting and managed services now, but we still do residential IT support. So, you know, I'll say it again, if you need help with your home computer, you can call us. Our contact info is on my card. It's on our agenda sheet as well. We're very reasonable. We have some current customers in the class here today. Ruth being one of those. We do good work. We got a good team on our hands, and we very good job, as opposed to some of the other larger corporate outfits. So feel free to give us a call with any needs like that. I've also got here today Wesley. He's one of our daytime commercial consulting specialists. Erica, she's our primary office technician. She handles most of the computers that come into the office that need repair. She's very good at what she does. And we have Lindsay here as well. Lindsay's our office manager that handles our scheduling day-to-day activities. So we've got a good part of our team here today. So if you need any help, if you brought a device, which you also use a cheat sheet. Everybody got a cheat sheet, okay. If you brought a device, this is a class where actually I would encourage you to take your device out. If you've got a Windows 8 device like you do up here, take it out, use it as we're going along. That's really how I structure this class. I'm gonna show how I'm doing things on the screen, and I encourage you to follow along as I'm doing things. You should be able to do everything I'm doing up on the screen. Most Windows 8 computers have been updated to the Windows 8.1 update by now. If you don't have it, I'll mention how you can get on that update, that point release that Microsoft came out with, as I'm training on the latest version of Windows 8 right now, and I'll help you out with that if you're not on that, update. Okay? So hopefully everyone's in the right spot for learning about Windows 8 today. And I also, before I get into the content, so that's something I added in very last minute, is I'm going to show a sneak peek of Windows 10. Windows 10 comes out next summer. Everyone that has Windows 8 is entitled to a free upgrade to it, as far as I'm hearing. So I'm going to just show what's coming in the new version of Windows. Yes, they're on a very fast release schedule now and making changes quickly. So, you know, by the time you go to rewatch this class in a few months, the new Windows is going to be on the market. But for now, I'm just, again, going to get your feet wet just to show you what's on the horizon, okay? So I covered most of this already. Again, the agenda is structured in a way so we can go over categories of items. And as I said, I'm doing this in a way so that you can follow along as I'm going ahead with the content here as we make our way through the material and some of the things I'm going to skip over. If there's something that you want me to show further at length or something I don't cover that you're interested in, I ask, perhaps save the question towards the end. I'm hoping to reserve hopefully a good 10 minutes or so, 10, 15 minutes for questions if possible. And I will be sure to answer as best we can every single question that comes up before we leave here today. If you need any help or assistance with your device, if you brought it here today and you can't figure out something and I'm moving a little bit too quickly, Erica has come here today to help out with sort of those, hey, I'm having an issue, I need to keep moving and I need some assistance. So just raise your hand if you're having an issue and Erica will definitely come by and she can help you out and get you moving, find you, you know, get you in the right place. Okay. We usually have a schedule of upcoming classes coming up. Unfortunately, we are dry right now. We really need to talk about what classes we're going to be offering. I know. We have nothing on the books yet, so we'll have to come up with a few items. And one thing I will say, you know, I like hearing from people in terms of what they want us to train on. I know our Android classes are popular, Windows 8 is popular, security is popular. I want to hear from you guys in terms of what you'd like to see us, you know, put a class on regarding. So if you go ahead and get the email from Ruth regarding the class link after this class is passed out next week, I'd really appreciate it. You could send some feedback and say, hey, I'd really love to see a class on this. No one's ever done this, you know, because as much as I like to think that, you know, we have a decent variety of items, there might be things that we're definitely passing on. And you know, the ball of the court is wide open. Go ahead.
Comment about that. So when you make your comments, and if Derrick is able to schedule a class, the upcoming quarter, he'll be able to come in and which would for our library take us through February, because December is part of it, then it may not end up, it would not appear in the printed newsletter.
The one thing that we offer on a consistent basis that never changes, we offer a free 3-hour help desk session at the Park Ridge Library the second Saturday of every month. It's almost like clockwork at this point. A lot of people are there regularly to get assistance from us. It's pretty much a 3-hour smorgasbord where we have our staff available, myself usually, or a combination of staff members there, and we answer any and all tech questions that you may have. Now, we're not going to reinstall Windows for you or, you know, go through a full malware cleanup for you while you're there, but we will go ahead. We'll help you out with Office. We'll help you with your tablet. We'll help you with something you're having trouble with Windows 8. So, you know, that's the kind of outlet you can use for that. And again, that happens every month. It's the second Saturday of every month, third floor of the Parkridge Library, from 9 a.m. to noon. So we definitely would love to see you come out there. And we're trying to get that kind of a schedule on a regular basis here at Niles Library as well. So hopefully we can rerun that at least a few times this next year in 2015. We did it once last year. We're trying to get it on a more routine basis at Niles. We'll be announcing when we redo it again at Niles. I'm hoping sometime in the spring we'll offer it, and perhaps in the summertime, late summer, you know, perhaps. I'm going to take a moment to mention, if you're still running an old computer with Windows XP or Office 2003, those two products are considered obsolete. They are dead. They are receiving no more support from Microsoft in any way. Hopefully everyone in this Windows 8 class is here to either purchasing a new computer or already has a new computer. If you are running Windows XP, you are at very high risk for a lot of the new malware, a lot of the attacks that are coming out on the internet. It's a very dangerous situation. We've been making our efforts to move our customers away from this aging platform. That piece of software, Windows XP, has lived far longer than Microsoft ever intended it to. And now we're living with some of those consequences. But again, Windows XP is something you should not be using on a day-to-day basis for doing any banking, email, anything with personal information on it. If you do have any Windows XP machines, they should be off the internet and relegated to a very secondary or tertiary purpose, okay? All right, I'm going to breeze over this as we're going to show a lot of this up on the screen as we go along. Some of the biggest things that have changed in Windows 8 over the previous versions, there's a start screen. There's no more start menu. Now, I'm going to have egg on my face because in Windows 10, the start menu is coming back in a little different form. So the start screen won't be here forever, but at least for now, Windows 8, the start screen is what is considered our primary app interface, okay? And I should have said no more start menu for now. Windows Store apps versus desktop apps, there's now a notion of applications that are considered applications that you get from the Windows Store. Like if you've used an iPad or an Android tablet, you know what those kind of apps are. And you're also used to what traditional apps are, right? Your QuickBooks, your traditional Office, things like that. There is this duality that's going to exist, at least probably for the next decade, as we transition everything away from traditional apps into now what they're calling universal apps, Windows Store universal apps. And that's moving in a direction of any app you get on a Windows phone is the same thing you can get on an Xbox, is the same thing you can get on a Windows tablet, is the same thing you get on a Windows computer. So that notion of bringing that experience together is something Microsoft's working very hard to do, and that is going to come to fruition once Windows 10 hits. They're about halfway there with Windows 8. Split screen app combinations, I'm going to show off some of the split screen capabilities that you can do with modern apps from the Windows Store, and how you can do multitasking using that. I think it's a pretty neat feature. And I'll show off how that functions. And this is also the first time that Windows has done the touch interface properly. I used to use a Windows XP-based tablet PC back in college. I thought it was great, but again, I'm a technical person. It doesn't make sense for the average person. But now Windows actually makes a lot of sense for touch, and they're doing a very good job in regards to that touch capability. And one of the other things that I love the most about Windows 8, I don't know about other people, but the fact that OneDrive is baked right into the operating system. You don't need a separate app. You don't need any extra programs installed. If you sign into your Microsoft account on a Windows 8 computer, you have access into your OneDrive account, which is cloud-free cloud storage and backup for your computer seamlessly behind the scenes and on the fly. And I'm not going to go too much into the OneDrive. We did two full classes on OneDrive this year. If you're interested in learning fully about that, you can rewatch that class, but that capability is fully caped into the experience now. I'm going to go over that a little bit later. Two ways to get Windows 8. You either purchase it on an PC or you purchase an upgrade for your old computer. A lot of people come to us and ask me, can I upgrade my Windows XP machine to Windows 8? Sometimes it can be done, sometimes it can't. Microsoft says that almost every computer that runs Windows 7 can run Windows 8. That is, for the most part, very true. But again, some people have hardware that's in not as great of a shape or not as new or has some issues. So I'm not going to say that every single computer can be upgraded. easiest way to get Windows 8, by and large, is just a purchase a new machine. There's so many devices out there that you can go with. Erica's using the new Surface Pro tablet. I think that's a great, great device. You have some of the cheaper Windows RT tablets that are out there. And then you've got everything in between, traditional laptops. I use a convertible tablet myself. There's a lot of options in the Windows sphere these days, so you're not really quartered into one thing now. Here is just a picture of some of the different devices that are out there. I've got a lot of customers that love the new touchscreen all-in-one desktops. These are nice. They're space-saving. Everything comes built into a single computer. It's like what the iMac does, but now in the Windows format. You have slate tablets like the Surface tablet, the Nokia Lumia 2520 tablet. You have these goofy hybrids. I personally never used one of these, but I guess some people like them. And again, everything under the sun in between. So a lot of neat choices out there. Great place to shop if you're actually looking for something for Christmas for someone in terms of a Windows 8 device. Micro Center, it's a computer store that you can go to in the city. I run Fullerton and Elston. There's a big Super Target over there. I always tell people, if they're not looking to buy a system through us, I would say go over there. They have great salespeople there. They're not there to give you the, Best Buy kind of salesperson experience. They do a very good job. So that's probably the one place I would say is a very, very good place that you can go purchase a device without getting ripped off. Micro Center is, they have two locations. One's in the city in Fullerton and Elston. And I'd say if you're going there, go there in the middle of the day, like between 10 and 2, so you don't hit traffic in the morning or the afternoon. It's for us from Park Ridge, it's a 15-20 minute drive if you go in the middle of the day. Very simple to get there. They also have a location out in the west suburbs. I rarely go to that one. Talked about that already. So some people ask, how do I know if I have Windows 8.1? Very simple. If you're on your desktop interface, your traditional desktop area, and you see a little Windows button on the bottom left-hand corner, you're running Windows 8.1. A lot of people that purchased original Windows 8 devices that came out in the initial part of the Windows 8 upbringing or time span got the regular Windows 8, which didn't have the update to it. So Windows 8 was the original. 8.1 is the newest point release. It's the latest version of Windows 8. I know it's confusing. That's just how the numbering scheme is working. So it's very simple. If you don't see a little start button or start Windows button on the bottom left-hand corner of your desktop, you know that you're running the original version of Windows 8. And in order to get the proper version of Windows 8.1, it's actually a free update. It's right from the Windows Store. I'll actually go over to my start screen really quickly. Your Windows Store is on your start screen area. My store is right over here. When you go into it, you'll be prompted. It's going to beat you over the face, beat you right over the head, to go ahead and update to Windows 8.1 for yourself. Sneaked in.
Yeah.
It sometimes is a little sneaky. So, but your store is going to look a little bit different if you're running original Windows 8. It's going to have these menus at the top like this. You'll have a big tile over here that says update to Windows 8.1. Of course, it doesn't show since I'm on it, but you will see that if you want to go ahead and update to that. So, definitely do that. There's a lot of performance enhancements, that battery saving, other bug fixes that went into Windows 8.1. So I would definitely recommend doing that. There's no reason not to make the update for yourself. Okay? And if you're curious about whether or not you have it and want to make sure you do, Erica can come and help you out with that as we go along. There we go. I showed how that looks right in there. That's the caption or pictures to shot of how that looks if you don't have it. This is how your Windows Store will look. All right, so we're going to jump into the fun stuff now. I'm going to get into usage now for Windows 8. But again, as I promised before I do, I'm going to bring up a Windows 10 just briefly because I know at the end we always run out of time. So let me go ahead and I just want to show everyone what that is looking like in terms of experience. So if you really want to, you can download Windows 10 today. You can use it. I wouldn't recommend doing it. It's more meant for the technical community to test out and for us to see what's coming in the next version of Windows, but it's open to everyone. There's no restriction on downloading it. You can put it on your computer system if you really want to. I'm doing it in a way that we do testing within, where we load it into what's called a virtual machine. So I've loaded Windows 10 into a virtual system to simulate the experience. I'm just going to bring this up temporarily here
just to get everyone's feet wet in terms of what's coming. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. No Windows. No Windows 9. No Windows 9.
The reason they didn't put out a Windows 9 is because there's a lot of old code out there in programs that search for and had some kind of that was searching for the old Windows 98. If you remember Windows 95, 98, there was programs that were coded in a way, in a bad way, that searched for those old copies of Windows. And if they made the new Windows Windows 9, there would have been a lot of problems with some. So that's the real reason that Windows 9 never came out to be. Okay?
Alright, let's get going. We'll see if we can sneak in a little Windows 10. Looks like everyone's anxious to learn about Windows 8, which is fine. We'll get right into it right now. So start screen. First off, I'm going to start off with the start screen. I'm not going to start off with a traditional desktop. We'll get to that in just a little bit. As you'll see, the start screen at a glance is pretty much divided into two sections. We have, first off, the top area, which is your customized area, so you're sort of, if you used an iPad or an Android tablet, you know there's a home screen, your primary screen that you have access to. That's pretty much what this is, your primary home screen. You customize it with the apps and the icons that you want to use. I'm going to show you how you can resize them, how you can move them around, put different apps on that start screen, and we'll get to that in just a moment. But again, if you're running Windows 8.1, there is also the All Apps area. I don't know the name, exact name for it, but if you, there's a little arrow on the, there's a little arrow on the bottom left-hand corner of the screen. Some of you can see it, some of you can't, but if you hit that, you'll be taken to a full list of all your apps on your computer. It's a little scary at first. It used to be divided up between modern apps and then more legacy traditional apps. Microsoft now has just put them all together, alphabetized them. So if you know the first part of the name, you can find that app for yourself. But I'm gonna tell you, don't get too caught up in this full app list. I'm just showing you that it exists. You don't necessarily have to use it. The way I'm gonna, you know, beat you over the head and tell you that the real way to be finding programs and applications for yourself and files on your computer is by searching. Don't use the hunt and peck. Search is too powerful in Windows 8. I'm going to show why it's so powerful in just a little bit. But there's not really a reason to be sitting here and scrolling through this huge list. I've got a very large list since I work with a lot of different apps every single day. I don't sit on this screen and search and hunt and peck for my apps. I search for everything that I need, or I pin a few things into my taskbar, my traditional desktop, for other items. But and I'll show you how that search experience looks in just a moment. One of the other things that you have to know about Windows 8 is there are three different types of input that you can use now, especially if you have a touchscreen. If you don't have a touchscreen, two of those are not going to matter. A keyboard and a mouse is all you're going to be able to use. But if you do have a touchscreen device, and this is where Windows 8 really starts to shine, is that you have three different options now. Well, I have three different options. If you have only touch, you don't have stylus input, you may not be able to do this. But by default, you can use keyboard and mouse. And this is the nice part about this, is that you can use the interface, every aspect of the interface, with your finger, with your stylus, or with your keyboard or mouse. You don't have to just use touch. I know Microsoft wants you to use touch, and everyone's talking about touch, but you don't have to. You can use keyboard and mouse just like you used to. And that's how I'm going to do a majority of my presentation here today. But, you know, there are applications that take advantage of stylus input. As you can see, I have a stylus pen. I can take notes for myself. This was from one of our classes on OneNote. I was making a pierogi recipe within OneNote, but again, I can handwrite those notes for myself. I can draw. If you're an artist, you can do, you know, things within Photoshop and programs like that that just weren't as possible before. So that's the touch experience, and of course, with your finger, it's a little tougher because my screen is bending a lot on me in the position I have it in, but I can scroll with my finger up, down, go between all the different areas of my computer. I can bring out my charms bar, which we'll go over in just a little bit. But again, your finger can be just as powerful as the mouse and keyboard. And some people prefer using the finger, right? Some people prefer, you know, touching what's on the screen and just using their finger as that natural experience. It's up to you. You don't have to use just one or the other. You can use a combination of those different methods, okay? Now, that little bar that I brought out from the right-hand side of the screen,
That is a bar that's universal across both the desktop and the start screen over here for ourselves. The little robot is jumping around the top here. I'll show you how you can change that to be less annoying if you want to. So this bar that comes out from the right-hand side of the screen is called the Charms Bar. Okay, this is a navigation aspect. This is a way that you can get into some of the common areas within Windows, whether or not you're within the desktop interface, or whether you're within the more traditional, the start screen style interface for yourself. There are a few common buttons that show up over here, and the way that to get into the Charms Bar, two ways. Take your finger, swipe in from the right-hand side of your screen, or just take your mouse cursor and put it either in the upper right-hand corner or the lower right-hand corner of your screen. That will pop out your Charms Bar. Okay? You have access to a few different things from the Charms Bar. You have access into search. You can search your entire machine right from here. It's not actually the way I do it. I'll show you the way I like to do it when we get to search in just a little bit. If you have social integration with Facebook, LinkedIn, some of the other services, you can easily share items from whatever app you're within using the Charms Bar share button. I don't have those services connected, so I'm not going to show that functionality off. You can dive into that on your own. The start button on the right-hand side over here, this is the start button that will get you, and again, you'll notice this theme. There are multiple ways to get to any spot within Windows 8. You don't have to just use that start button to get between the start screen and the traditional desktop. I prefer to do it using the start key on my keyboard, the little Windows key. It takes me back and forth between my two different screens. That's my preferred way to do it. Some people prefer to use their Charms Bar and hit the start button on there. And again, you'll see it takes me to the same place. So again, you have to get comfortable with the way that you want to do it. I'm not showing you the one and only way that something can be done here. So if I bring back up my Charms Bar, I have a settings button or devices button that I can go into where I can see all the common devices, printers, phones connected to my device, other peripherals I've connected, so an easy way to get into that area. And then settings I can go into, and this is how you can shut your machine down easily. I have a power button here, and I can turn off my system or put it to sleep or restart it. I can get into the more traditional control panel from here. And one thing I want to mention is that the Charms Bar options do change slightly depending on the context of where you are. So if I'm within my start screen, for example, and I go into my Charms Bar, the settings I get are slightly different because I'm on the start screen, right? Instead of having that a big area that said control panel, I believe up here, now there's just simply a change PC settings area, right? So that's a little bit confusing. All the items in terms of the full-fledged functionality of the control panels available from the traditional desktop. This is not as, doesn't have as many options in this change PC settings area. And I should bring it up for you because you're gonna say, what does it look like? It looks like this. It covers more of your, some of your simpler items like your desktop background screen for your lock screen, your account picture, what accounts you have signed into your device. And I'm gonna go into this a little bit further. So that's our Charms Bar, and again, we can get into that, as I said, using your finger, or using your mouse and keyboard if you want to. So let's go over the notion of the tiles, right? So this is probably the item that throws a lot of people off: is what are these tiles? What are they doing here? Why are they here? And how can I get rid of them? Or how can I add tiles? How can I move them around? And I want to go into that and show you how to do that. So by default, when you get a Windows 8 computer, you're going to have a default layout, right? That's going to have your desktop icon on the left side. You're going to have a lot of the default apps that come with the machine. But you can add on to this, of course, right through the Windows Store. And we're going to show off the Windows Store in just a little bit here and how you can install applications for yourself. But these tiles, all they are for the most part, are just entry points into the programs they represent, right? If you've used an iPad, you know this experience. You have icons that take you into an application. However, these go further. They're not just icons. They're also, a lot of them have functionality like this. Our news tile shows me scrolling news. And this is neat because I don't have to now go into every single app to get all the information I'm looking for. I can, for example, see some of that scrolling news and get just a brief idea of what's going on. I can get a brief idea of how the weather is without having to go into it. Right? So these are called live tiles. They change dynamically, they change on the fly, they change as information within the app where news stories are changing or the weather's changing, they're not just standard icons like you have on an Android tablet or an Apple device. They actually do a little bit more. And they're fully resizable, customizable, and it would show you how you can make those changes. So up on my, and just so you know, the only area where you can change these tiles and customize them is your home screen area. This whole area up here, you can't put any tiles down in the full apps area. That's just meant to be your alphabetical listing of everything on your machine, right? Your customizable area is your personal start screen, which is visible here. You go to your start screen, this is the first thing you see. This is your home screen. This is what you can go ahead and change. So for example, if I didn't want to have a particular tile on my start screen, what could I do? I can use my finger. So sometimes I'll describe how you can do it with your finger, how you can do it with your mouse button and keyboard. I tend to use the mouse button and keyboard most often. So I'm gonna go ahead, I can right click on an icon and I can do unpin from start. If I do unprint from start, it's gone. But it's not gone forever. It's just gone from my start screen. Because if I go into my full apps list and I go over to P for people, I should be able to find that item right there. So it doesn't uninstall it. It's the same notion of how Android tablets, if you have an Android tablet, treat their home screen. You can get rid of icons on your primary home screen, but it doesn't necessarily remove the application for you. The same concept applies in the Windows 8 ecosystem, okay? I can also go ahead and I can move these tiles around. Grab onto a tile with your left mouse button or hold down with your finger, and I can move it wherever I want to. I'm using my finger right now, and I can move this around to wherever I want it to sit for myself. Drop it, tap once, and there it is. I just recustomized where I want things to sit. For some people, finger and mouse may be easier. For me, using the mouse, very easy as well. I can move things around. If I don't want this item over here, I can just unpin it from the start and it will be gone. There's also the option where you can resize these tiles. So not only can we move them, not only can we add tiles on the screen, we can also resize our live tiles. So for example, you'll see that my large news icon here for the news tile is very large. This is probably considered like an extra large. Or large, it's considered a large tile. If I right click on that tile with my mouse and I go to resize, you'll see you have multiple different options for sizing. Now some tiles, not all tiles have all four options of small, medium, wide, large. News is an app that does happen to have those four options. I can change it, it can be a very small tile with no scrolling information. I can choose to have a little bit larger, medium size where it's a little bit larger. I can do a wide tile like that. And again, I can move it around depending on my, you know, on how large I want it to be and where I want it to sit. I like my news tile being big because I'm a news junkie. I'm gonna make that very large, and I like that actually being closer to the front part of my start screen. And again, if you're using your finger, you can go ahead and you can hold down, tap and hold with your finger on the screen. And that will bring up some of the same options that I was showing you with the mouse button, except they show on the bottom tile bar now for us. Resize, uninstall, the same options I had when I right click with my mouse are just on the bottom of the screen there. You'll see them right at the bottom of the screen, hidden by the chairs a little bit over there. But again, you'll see the context and the way it shows is just a little bit different if you're using your finger or you're using the mouse, again, to make that easier depending on what input device you're choosing to use, okay? Turn live tile off, we'll go ahead and turn off all the scrolling information that's showing up. So like my news tile showing all the news stories, if you turn that off, if I turn this off, it'll just become a blank, bland icon in my opinion, okay? Some people don't like all the scrolling information, some people do. The choice is up to you whether or not you want to have that information showing for your clients, okay? So those are our tiles, and again, as your start screen gets bigger and bigger and you add more items onto it, and I should show people how to add new icons onto it. If there's something that you install on your machine, and I'll show how to do new applications from the Windows Store in just a moment, but if there's something that's missing off of your start screen that you wish you had, all you have to do is go into your full apps list, and you can use your finger or the mouse button, tap and hold, for example, with your finger, and I could say, pin to start. Now I have my calculator app
showing here. Now I can even go ahead and I can resize that if I want to. See, do I have an option to make it bigger, or I can only have an option to make it a little bit smaller? So any app that is considered an app from the Windows Store, or what's going to be called a universal app very soon, I can take out of my all apps list here, and I can go ahead and pin it up on my start screen for myself. Food and drink, I'll take that. I'll pin that to my start. And there we go. Now it's scrolling with some lovely recipes that and as you add more, your start screen will just grow with you. It'll keep growing further to the right. So there's no such thing as a limit for how big it can be. Yeah, you'll have to scroll a little bit more from left to right, but as many apps as you can fit on your computer, it'll just keep adding on to the right, and you can keep moving things around. Play with them as you like, customize it to however you want it to be, however you want it to behave, okay? So again, I talked about that notion of desktop apps versus Windows Store apps, right? This is a Windows Store app. It opens in full screen. It is a dedicated or a single purpose application that takes over the entire screen for me. This comes from the Windows Store. There we go. Thanksgiving leftover recipes. Very timely. So this is more of a modern app, as they call it. But of course, in Windows 8, we still have access into our traditional desktop. And actually, as you'll see, the desktop is just an icon on your start screen. The desktop is meant to be its own application, sort of, right? It's a little bit confusing to some people, but again, it's just a subset of the start screen area. If we go into our desktop, this is primarily what I work with in day-to-day, right? The more traditional Windows interface that more people are used to. But again, I have access to this with a single click. I just use my little Windows key on my keyboard. I tap between it, I can go between my start screen and my traditional desktop. That's how I do it. But again, there's multiple different ways. Your times bar, if you have a Windows tablet with a dedicated Windows key button on the actual screen itself, that will take you back and forth. So there are so many different ways to go back and forth between these different apps. And of course, on my traditional desktop, I have, you know, all the different same kind of old style apps that I used to use in the past. You have your regular, this computer, this PC, where you can get access to everything as you used to. And I'm going to touch on this a little bit, you know, more towards the end of class. This hasn't changed very much. There are some nuances to it, but it's still there. It's the same Windows that we know and love. Okay? So let's go back into a modern application. I'm going to go back into, let's go into news, for example. And this is actually something that's changed since the last time that I presented our Windows 8 class. It used to be that for when you were using your keyboard and mouse, you had the option to go ahead and hold at the top of the screen and swipe down, throw the application away. Well, now for mouse and keyboard users, it's a little bit different in that if you want to close out an app and you're using your mouse and keyboard, all you have to do is take your mouse cursor to the top of the screen, and you now have a more traditional option to exit out or minimize it. So again, it's a little bit different than how Windows 8 did it when it initially came out, before there was the concept of trying to replicate the touch experience of the mouse and keyboard. Microsoft said, you know what, let's make it a little bit easier. So you put your mouse cursor towards the top of the screen, and you will get an option right away to minimize or close out the application. If you're using touch input with your fingers or your stylus, the same concept applies in terms of you take your finger from the top of the screen, and you're going to swipe down and throw the application away. Let me do that one more time. I know it's very fast and it came very quickly, but if you're using your mouse or your finger to close out an application, hold your finger at the top of the screen and swipe down, directly down. It's called tossing the application away, closing it via tossing it. Okay? You can do it one of two ways for yourself. If you're using finger, you know, obviously use the input, you know, based upon what you choose to do. But now there's, so again, a little different way based upon if you're using a keyboard and mouse or if you're doing the touch experience. When I'm within modern apps, there is usually an option to go ahead and I can bring up my charms bar if I need to on the right-hand side of the screen, scrolling in from the right with my finger, or just bringing my mouse cursor to the right-hand side of the screen. And everyone asks, where are my options, right? Everyone's so used to having so many toolbars and options in Windows that it's almost scary. There's no options to do anything if you don't see it up on the screen. Well, the way to get into options
in any modern app is to go ahead and right-click on the actual application itself. You can right-click right on any of the common area, and as you'll see, now I'm brought to all my settings and options that I can choose to use for this particular app. So this news app has different options and features than perhaps another app would have. I go back into my start screen and I go into my travel app and go in, well, I mean, these are very similar. They're both Microsoft apps. Let me go back to my start screen. I'll open Fresh Paint, for example. Very neat, simple drawing program you can use if you like to draw. If I go in here, and if I right click, now I have different options, right? This is a drawing program and I can choose, you know, different colors to go ahead and draw for myself and do what I need to do within there. So again, the options and the menus do change depending on the program, very similarly to how the Android and the iPad tablets do it, right? It's very contextual based upon where you are. So when I close out of it, same concept, mouse cursor up top, exit out, and I'm gone. Or I can even minimize it if I want to. I can minimize that application and it will go ahead and it will show up on my taskbar. If you're in the traditional desktop, you can see now that you have access to open up any of your modern apps right from the taskbar for yourself. This wasn't the case before with regular Windows 8. Now you can. If I'm within my traditional office or working with an Excel, I can switch back and forth between my different programs very easily. So that notion of legacy versus modern apps is being molded further together more and more, where the difference is going to be almost non-existent very soon. Okay? Go ahead. Yes. So let's go over that really quickly. An app is just basically a program that comes from the new modern Windows store. You call that an app, right? You have apps on your phone, you have apps on your tablet. A lot of these things up here, these are just little apps. We call those apps. Programs is the term we use for more traditional programs. Office, Quicken, QuickBooks, all those old programs we used to use on our computer and install off CDs or floppy disks back in the day. Those are more considered programs. Charm is just a menu that shows up in Windows 8 on the right-hand side of the screen. Whether I slide in with my finger from the right-hand side or with my mouse, Charm is just this bar over here. It's called the Charms bar. It's not a separate program within itself. It's just a feature of the interface. Okay? So hopefully that makes sense. Go. Sorry. So if I take, so two ways, mouse cursor on the upper right-hand side or lower right-hand side of my screen, or with my finger, swipe in from the right-hand side with my finger, brings up my Charms bar. This is my Charms bar. And this shows up whether you're within legacy desktop, traditional desktop, or whether you're within this new start style screen.
Now, to do it with your finger, you have to have that kind of touch screen.
To do with your finger, you have to have a touch screen. Not all Windows 8 computers have touch screens.
Because I can't do it. So
if you can't do it, you don't have a touch screen more than likely. So that's probably why that is happening for you, okay? Yeah, so if you're touching your screen and you can't do the things with your finger like I'm showing, it's probably because your laptop or device doesn't have a touch screen.
I
so
don't like all those
then that's fine. And like I said, you can use your mouse and keyboard to do everything I'm showing up here on the screen. Again, it's just a different experience if you have a touch screen and you want to use your finger to go ahead and do this. So let's keep moving here. Let's go into the Windows Store, right? Everyone loves apps. We are app hungry these days. So this is how we can go ahead and purchase apps for ourselves, or free apps. There's plenty of free apps out there. You don't necessarily have to purchase apps for yourself. And again, these are the apps that are going to show up on our modern interface, our start screen over here, as tiles. So let's go into the Windows Store. It's a tile itself. And of course, I can go ahead and browse if you've been in the Apple App Store or the Android Google Play Store. For yourself, it's, you know, they all have their own ways of organizing the information and content. But this is just the way that the Windows Store organizes it. So you can browse by categories. You can go ahead and look at the charts in terms of top three games or top three apps or the best free apps or top paid apps. So any of those different charts that you may be interested in. So I can do it that way. The way I tell people most of the time to do it is just go ahead and search for it, right? No matter what you're looking for, you can probably find it just by searching for it. Netflix is already on the screen. If I do a search for Netflix here, I can bring up Netflix. And again, remember, you're not only going to find the exact item that you're looking for, you're going to find items that are similar to what you're looking for. So I searched for Netflix, but I also got other items that are either competitors to Netflix, like Hulu, or other apps that simulate some of Netflix capability, like Netflix Tonight probably. Again, it tells you what it does here. Search Netflix online movies based on release date. So again, you'll find a lot of different items, you know, based upon whatever you're searching for. And you don't necessarily have to know the name of the exact app you're looking for, right? If you just want to go ahead and, you know, do a search for news, you can go ahead and do a search for news, and it'll bring up all the different news apps, for example, or apps that fit that genre of news. And there are plenty of different things. And also, there are plenty of different apps that are completely free out there, right? You don't necessarily have to pay for any apps. If you're the kind of person that just wants to get away with free, you can do it in the Windows Store. Right, so I did a search for news here. I've got a few of these news programs installed already. CNN is free. Flipboard I have on here. I'll show Flipboard. That's one of my favorite apps off the Windows Store. It's on other devices as well. It's like a digital magazine, probably the closest nice digital magazine I've seen yet. But again, a lot of different apps. And again, you have to be careful when you're searching for apps in here, right? Not everything that's in here is going to be something worth your time. So how do we know whether it's something that we're interested in putting on our computer? Well, the same way that we do it on the Android or the iPad stores. We can see easily how many people have installed it, or not installed it, how many people have reviewed it, and what kind of star rating it has, right? If I go into this AOL Today app over here, I can go ahead and I can read the reviews on this app by scrolling over. It's got a 3.5 star rating, and I can see what some of the most recent people have said about it. It freezes, not for Windows 8.1, cannot open email. I don't know, some, you know, people have a lot to say about it. But again, you can get a feel for whether or not you want to go ahead and put that app on before you even install it. So it's good. You can do that kind of window shopping, you know, that you're used to on the other devices out there. Every single app out there has a description that you can see on the left-hand side for yourself. It's got screenshots that you can go between to see what that app looks like. So you should have a pretty good idea of what it is before you even install it. But regardless, even if you do want to install it, even if you didn't take the time to research it heavily, it's not a big deal, right? And unlike more traditional apps that take a lot of time and effort to install, these things are very simple and easy to install. It's a matter of one single click, the install button. There we go. When I tap on it, there we go. As it installs, you'll see the little scrolling progress bar on the up, on the top, through the five-dot little scroll loading dots. It'll tell me that's installing it. If I click on it, it'll tell me, and then it'll actually bring up an icon that tells me AOL Toolbar, or Today, was installed. And if I want to go right into it, I can click or tap on that icon, and it'll take me right into my new application that I just installed. And there it is. So I pulled it off the Windows Store, I installed it, I clicked on the install button, and there we go. There I have it. I've got weather, I've got business, I've got, you know, whatever comes with this particular program. And there are a lot of programs out there. I mean, last I heard the count of programs, we were at about 500,000 apps within the Windows Store today. There is more than enough for everyone, no matter what you're looking for. If I go back to the Windows Store and do a search for games, I can do a search for crossword puzzles. A lot of people like to do crossword puzzles. Free. There's plenty of free good stuff out there, no matter what your interests are. Do some searches on here. Go find stuff that you're interested in. If I do a search for sports, I've got ESPN apps. I've got all kinds of baseball, football apps. I can tactics board. If I'm coaching a team, I guess I can do plays on here. But you know, anything under the sun. Most of the large apps that are available on the Apple Store and the Google Play Store are here. The few that aren't are going to be here very, very soon. So the playing field is nearly level at this point between the different ecosystems. How do you pay? If there's an app that you need to pay for, there will be an option. It'll tell you to go ahead and you'll be able to have a chance to put a credit card and attach it to your Microsoft account for yourself. So it'll walk you through that. If there's an app that you want to pay for, like this is a golf swing app, I guess, that will show you what you're doing wrong in baseball or
how much about the apps cost?
It varies. I would say the median probably somewhere between $1 to $3. somewhere around there. I have not seen apps. There's very few apps that are over the $5 to $7 price range. It has to be a very special app to be that. iTunes is a separate store. iTunes is for Apple's ecosystem, right? We are in the Windows ecosystem, so we are dealing with the Windows store now. So it's based upon what device you're trying to use, right? And you have to remember now that purchases you make in the Apple store don't carry over to the Windows store. So this is something you have to be mindful of. If you've gone and paid for a lot of apps in the Apple store, and now you're jumping on a Windows tablet or Windows computer expecting to have all that good stuff for free, it's not going to happen. Right? The concept that does apply, though, is going to happen because Microsoft is consolidating all these apps under the Windows Store. When you pay, for example, the new version of Office is going to come out as a Windows Store app. You pay for it once through here, you're going to have access to it on your phone, you'll have access to it on your other Windows devices. So that concept will travel between devices, but it doesn't travel between Google Store and Microsoft Store and Apple Store. Okay? So I do want to make that note so no one is confused about that notion. All our competing application stores. So that is the Windows Store. I guess the one thing I didn't show off is how to uninstall an application that I put on my machine. I go back to my start screen. I can go ahead and I can right click or hold with my finger on an application. Well, if I right click on it, it'll ask me to uninstall from here. Or I can do a tap and hold with my finger, and you'll see that at the bottom of the screen now I can click on uninstall. If I tap uninstall on the bottom of the screen, it will tell me it'll uninstall the app, and any application data will also be lost. I'm fine with that. I have nothing on Amazon that I care about right now on my app. So I'm going to hit uninstall, and that's it. It doesn't entail anything else. It's just as simple as uninstalling it on your iPad or your Android tablet or your smartphone. No, since I uninstalled it, it actually got rid of it entirely off my computer. If I wanted to get rid of it, if I wanted to get it back now, I would have to go back in the Windows Store, find it again, and reinstall it for myself. Yeah. So that was that. What I just did right now was different than taking it off my start screen. Taking it off my start screen was holding down with my finger and do unpin from start. That just removes the icon. Uninstalling it is just as it sounds. Uninstalling it completely from your machine. Okay? So again, I did a little bit of demo of some of the apps that are available out there. Again, this is something I could spend all day on, the different apps that are available out there. Some of the neat apps that I have on my tablet that I particularly like, they have a pretty neat maps app that you can use if you're interested in mapping something out or, you know, finding directions to somewhere that you're going. So it's a nice full screen app that you can bring up and zoom in and zoom out. So it's pretty powerful. If you like Google Maps, this is very comparable to that. This is a completely free app right from Microsoft. Fresh Paint, if you like to draw, Fresh Paint is a program that you can use to, as I showed, you can, you know, draw and make designs, you know, for yourself on here. If you're a painter, this is sort of, you know, a painting canvas for someone that's not as in-depth in the graphics industry. This is probably more meant for kids or people just doing it on an amateur basis. If you're really interested in drawing nicely with, you know, a more advanced program, you can use things like Photoshop or Adobe Illustrator with touch input if you buy a stylus-based device, and you can draw with that if you want to, okay? Do I have photos on here?
What, in terms of what, like
Photoshop? I don't have Photoshop. I don't do graphic design, things of that nature, but I know customers some other apps that you can get here. Flipboard. Where was my Flipboard? Here we go. Flipboard is pretty neat. This is a news style news digital magazine that goes across different content categories, and it's very neat because just like a regular magazine, I can go ahead and flip. I can flip this just like a traditional magazine with my finger from left to right. So if I go into a story, I flip it, and I'm just holding with my finger. Again, simulating as best you can, flipping a page on a screen for yourself. So it's pretty neat. If you're a news junkie, you like flipping through the news, or if you're someone that has liked the experience of a newspaper or a magazine, this is probably the closest
the closest that you'll get to a very nice, completely free, doesn't cost a thing. If you sign up for an account on here, you can customize the kind of news stories that you happen to get on here. They have videos as well that toss in news videos for you, but I can, you know, peruse the news, peruse my sports news and all that. A very good app, and I talk about this app in our Android class as well. This is a cross-platform app, so this is available on all of the different devices out there.
So if you install the Swift, it works on any of the other apps, or
just certain ones? This is just functionality related to this app. This is just for Flipboard. I'm showing you what Flipboard has to offer right now. When I was showing FreshPaint, that's just what FreshPaint has to offer.
You're going from here to here on Flipboard?
Yeah. So this is just news within that, within the Flipboard. I wouldn't find this within the Microsoft News program, for example. This is specific just to Flipboard itself.
And with your
mouse? You can do it with your mouse if you want. You can just hold down and go back and forth between the mouse. Actually, with the mouse, it's kind of clumsy. You actually have to, on the bottom of the screen, there's little sections, and you can go ahead and flip between the different sections by clicking on them. With this app, this is a very touch-centric app. This is meant for your finger. You take your finger, and I'm just dragging it like I would be dragging a newspaper page for myself. So this is one app that really shows how touch is very, very nice for a program like this.
Which app were you using that you said was good?
Which app?
No, the Maps.
Oh, the Maps app? That was, it's just called Maps. It actually comes pre-installed by default. You can find it right on your start screen, probably. Yeah, you probably have it already. It's a default app that uses the Bing Maps engine, and you can do direction searches. You can search for locations. You know, we can search for Niles Library if you wanted to, and it should bring us right up information. Hours of operation. I can call them right from here. I can get crazy with this app. So a lot of different things that you can do. Hey, you probably got to have a headset on here. I'm not exactly sure the calling functionality would work. I've got a program where I can make phone calls on here, but you know, most people don't have that kind of app. But again, a lot of things that you need to try, and you know, try on your own, play with a little bit. I'm not going
to
show off every detail of every app.
I thought you didn't connect
your
phone or something.
No. I mean,
you can make calls, though, if you figure it out.
I guess it would try to make a call using my Lync app that I have. It's a business messaging app that we have for business. So those are just some of the apps. Again, I have more apps on here. I'm not going to go too crazy in the apps. I want to keep going on the content. I showed you how to go in the Windows Store. I've showed you how to go ahead and search for items, how to install things, how to move icons around, your live tiles across from your start screen. Once you play with it a little bit, you'll think you'll really, you know, get the hang of it. It's not that hard of a concept, right? I mean, you know, think of them, you were using computers back when we changed from Command Prompt into Windows 95 or Windows 98. This is the same kind of generational leap that we're making with this concept. It's now that touch is the primary aspect and not the keyboard and mouse. Okay, even though we can do everything with the keyboard and mouse that I showed off here today. If you want to personalize the start screen a little bit for yourself, you can do so. If I bring up my charms bar, this is where the charms bar comes into play. If I'm on my start screen and I want to customize, for example, a little goofy robot that's flying around at the top of the screen, if that's not your style, I can go into my charms bar, which is, again, mouse finger from the right, swipe in, or mouse on the bottom right-hand corner or top right-hand corner. And if I go into settings here and go into change PC settings, I can personalize some of these options for myself. I can personalize my lock screen that I have here. There's a few different defaults. You can choose a picture that you have for yourself. So you can, you know, you can go ahead and make that choice. You can change your account picture. If you choose to use a picture password, which is something that you move your finger around to unlock your screen, you can choose your picture password right from there as well. And I can also go ahead if I go back into my charms bar and I click on the option that says settings and personalize. This is where I have the exact options to change now the background color. I can change my tint. Oh, that's a little too bright. Gotta be careful there. Change my background color, my picture. They have some very wacky, goofy pictures that you can use over here, whether or not some of these fit your tastes or not. But again, there's a lot to choose from. You can really, you know, make this your own. The notion is, you know, customize it for how you want it to be. You don't have to use what comes out of the box. All right, there we go. cityscape background for ourselves. And we can change our color as well. And I can change my accents as well. So a lot of customization options. Again, you can be here all day with all the customization that they offer up on Windows 8. Alright, that's a little brighter than I like that. Yes, do you have a question? Yes,
what,
go ahead.
What about sending pictures? Has that changed much? If I want to send a picture to Facebook or I want to send a picture, is that basically the same?
You could do it the same way you've always done it. If you bring up your photos on here, again, I don't have any photos to play around and test with right now, but if you do tie your social accounts into the share area here, you tie your Facebook in, you can easily share pictures right from your photos area right up to your Facebook or your LinkedIn or your Twitter account, whatever else that you use in the social sphere. So yes, that has been made easier. You don't necessarily have to email everything like you used to. So that is definitely in here. Again, I don't have my social accounts tied into here, but you can easily tie them in by going to the share area off the charms bar, log yourself in, and you'll get that contextual capability to share things out very quickly with those avenues. Okay? So I showed off some of the personalization of the start screen. We showed off how we can move tiles around and customize where things are located there. I want to bring up search. Again, I talked about how powerful search is in Windows 8, right? Instead of using this big list of apps here and finding and having to remember, well, what was it called? Was it called News or NBC News or MSN News? I can go ahead and I can search for those items very easily. And the way that I do search most of the time, since I'm working in the desktop interface, myself on a day-to-day basis, I go ahead and I'm usually going ahead and just doing a search by hitting my little Windows button on my keyboard, which is the same thing as hitting the Windows button on the bottom left-hand side of your screen. Again, multiple different ways to get back to the start screen. As soon as I get back to the start screen, I don't even have to hit the search button, even though I could just start typing. So if I'm looking for my news app, I just start typing news, and there it is. My news items just came up. If I'm looking for my sports app, type in sports. There's my one sports app, my sports app that I have on there. I think I have ESPN on there. Start typing it in, right? This search functionality is searching across your whole computer. It's searching across your modern apps. It's searching across your legacy apps. It's searching across the files that you have on your computer. It's searching everything. There's no need to hunt and peck anymore. Go back to your start screen, start typing your search term in, and more than likely you're going to find what you're looking for just by starting to type in those first few characters. So if you like the way that search was done in Windows 7, you're going to love the way that search is done in Windows 8. It's even easier and even more powerful in the new version. That's how I get my programs most of the time. You just have to, when you do a search for it, you just have to go ahead and make sure you're hitting the right icon. So if I type in Excel, right? My Excel showed up right there. I could tap on Excel. It opens up Excel. And it's the same thing I can do with my mouse and keyboard if I wanted to. If I wanted to open up Word, I can start typing in Word. Hit Word. It'll bring up Word. That is a function that's related to the actual program itself. So Office, yes, we'll have your recently saved files with it. So again, some functionality is from the Windows 8 side. Some is still baked into the program that you're using. So Office still works the same way as Office has always worked. You'll still have your recently used files within there. Again, that will be visible once you get into the program itself.
Is Cloud, would it be another class?
The OneDrive aspect of this,
I don't
Cloud?
Know. I know nothing.
That is probably what you're referring to in terms of the cloud for Windows 8. And yes, that is a whole separate class that I've run. We're probably going to redo it in 2015, but I don't have enough time to go into the whole cloud aspects of all this. I'm going to touch on it very briefly. So that's how I do it. You can very easily search for anything you're looking for that applies to files, that applies to apps as well that you have. And again, it applies not just to the modern apps, it applies to legacy apps as well. If I type in PowerPoint, I find PowerPoint, whatever else I'm looking for. And it's not just apps, it's not just files. I can go into PC settings that I'm looking for. I typed in power, what did they think I was looking for? Change my power and sleep settings. Change when the PC sleeps. Choose when to turn off the screen if I'm on battery power. So it contextually is looking through settings on my computer. So I can search for almost anything that I might be looking for as long as it's on the system somewhere. Here we go. It's finding some PowerPoint files from when I was doing my undergraduate degree in college. It's finding old files from my OneDrive. So, again, that search is working across the board, across the entire system. Okay? Any questions on search? Pretty simple. I went back to my start screen,
right,
and I tapped my Windows key on my keyboard to get there.
Okay.
And now
okay.
I'm here.
Right.
And if I'm using a keyboard and mouse, if you're using touch, you're going to have to go ahead and hit the search button and put with your finger so you can do a touch search, right? But since I'm using my keyboard and mouse right now, I just start typing on my keyboard. I just start typing. That's all.
You don't go back.
That's why I said it's so simple. I don't have to hit anything. I don't have to use the charms in this instance. I can if I want to. It's an optional way of doing it, but I find this to be faster. Just type. What are you going to do? Just start typing. Windows Explorer is still there. I'll get to Windows Explorer when I get to the desktop section. But you can still use that. Go into My Computer as you used to, and I'll show that a little bit as we move forward. So one of the neatest functionalities that we have in here is called the split screen option. We can multitask modern apps with our legacy desktop experience. So what do I mean by that? Let me show you. A lot of people find this very cool. So for example, I could have open my Maps app. Let's open up Maps. And let's go ahead and I'm gonna take my mouse cursor to the upper left-hand side of the screen. And I can go ahead and I can do this with my finger or the mouse. I'm doing it with my mouse right now. If I bring my mouse cursor to the upper left-hand side of the screen, it brings up my area to bring up my items that are open behind the scenes. This is like the modern version of the taskbar, just for my desktop and my other modern apps I have open. So now I can go ahead and I can drag in my traditional desktop. Hold down on my desktop, drag in, and if I put it on the right-hand side, it brings up a split screen for me. And I can resize this to different sizes if I want to. So I can work on an Excel document over here while referencing something in an app on the left-hand side that's a modern app. And if I have a larger screen, I can do a split screen. I can do three different apps. If I have more screens on my computer, I can stack them even further. Windows knows how much space you have on your desktop. It will give you more room to do even more split screens for yourself. Since my screen's so small, I can only do two apps at a time. If you didn't get anything, you might not have anything else open. But you do have something, actually. You had your desktop open. You can drag your desktop in. That's exactly what I just did. If I don't want something, all I have to do is close out of that split screen. Get it out. Close it out. I'm back to my desktop now. If I want to do a split screen to my Flipboard, I want to read my news on the right-hand side. Bring it to the right. Open it. And there we go. And the computer will resize. The application is smart enough. It has a few different preset sizes. Some apps can go very small. Some apps can't. Flipboard doesn't like to go any smaller than that. But again, this is a much nicer experience than a larger screen. A larger screen, you can have a much larger experience for every single app you have open, and you'll have more viewable space within it. My main screen is very small since it's a laptop. I can only show you so much with this. But you get the picture for what can be done with this. Because what I'm doing, when I went ahead in my opened items list up here, I held down on it with my finger or my mouse, and I dragged it in. When I drag it into a side of my screen, it sets up my split screen. If I have a larger screen, I'll have an option to do a three split screen cut, or more, depending on your screen size. Automatically, I didn't do anything else. I'm holding down my mouse button, and I'm just dragging it. Either side. And like I said, some apps can go smaller. You'll see it'll move itself to the spot where you can go smaller. If you go too small, it just thinks you're closing it out. But for news, I can go that small and I can bring up more in my desktop. So I can get my work done, I can look at my stock ticker, I can get my do my emails, and I can look at my sports scores. The combination's up to you. You know, what you do with it is really, you know, the sky's the limit, but the functionality's there. And one of the things that's coming in Windows 10 is they're taking this a step further. We'll be able to have modern apps floating around our desktop, this next side by side with our legacy apps. So we can actually have little tiled apps
on our desktop that we can move around just like our old apps that we used to work with. So right now it's just split screen. In Windows 10, it's going to go that one step further, so it's going to be even better. But for now, split screen works pretty well. It gets the job done. I use it from time to time myself. I like it. You know, I think it's a pretty neat feature. How to close is very simple. I can go ahead and I can bring my mouse cursor up to the top of that app, and it brings up that little menu to close out or minimize. Or the way I'm used to doing it is I just close out that split screen. Hold on with my finger on that divider, whoop, swipe it out. All gone. Split screen closed. If I want to bring it back, take my finger or my mouse cursor, upper left-hand side, wait till your options show, scroll down a little bit, and I can bring up my recipes now on the right-hand side. Write my mom an email about the cool recipe I found while viewing it right on the right-hand side of my screen. And I don't have to flip back and forth between full screen and my desktop. I can use that now in a side-by-side experience. So very neat, very cool.
What's the difference between, you said, modern and legacy?
So legacy is what I have on the left-hand side, called, you know, old school Windows, call it that, right? This is new school Windows. Right-hand side is my modern. And as time goes on, more and more what Windows is going to be, in modern application form, we're going to be seeing less and less programs that are going to be released on this legacy style interface. So this is the future, and this is really what's going to be taking over the next 3 to 5 years or so. But for now, of course, we have a duality, and we need to live in this dual screen style environment, and these are the kind of options we have to be able to use the old style apps and our new style apps. Again, if I don't want it, the way I like to do it, again, just hold down on the divider and swipe out. So now I'm back to my traditional desktop. That's pretty cool. I really like the split screen functionality. And again, it really shines if you have a nice large 22, 23, 24 inch monitor. You can really set up some nice split screens for yourself, 2, 3, 4 apps, and really, you know, make that functionality shine. But on a laptop, you know, it still does function just on a little basis. Any questions about split screen or opening up other applications? If you don't want a split screen, you don't have to. You know, I could just go into my full Flipboard app using that little area. I can just go into travel app in full screen mode. I don't have to split screen everything. It's meant to be there and used on a basis when you need it, not every single time you want to use it. And I can even split screen. So I showed you how to split screen a desktop, my traditional desktop, and a modern app. But I can split screen maps and travel. Maps, travel. Can do with any app. Desktop and an app, two apps, multiple different apps, desktop and multiple apps if I have a bigger screen. You know, any combination that you can think of, you can go ahead and make split screens, and I can again resize it depending on what needs to be smaller, what needs to be larger. Okay? Alright, enough of split screen. I want to touch on OneDrive really quickly, but before I do that, a lot of people ask me, how do I shut my computer down? I don't know how to turn my computer off. I'm used to my big start button and my shutdown button being there. Three different ways you can do it. So let me show you the way that I like to show people. The easiest way to do it is on your start screen, you have a big power button right on the top. You can hit that and it'll give you the options to put it to sleep, to restart it, or shut it down fully. Another way you can do it is off the charms bar. If I bring up my charms bar and I click on the settings button, I have a power button there I can shut it off from. So that's way number two. Same functionality, just a different spot. The final way that I use the most, because again, I'm a geeky person and I'm in desktop mode so much of the day, I actually right click on my start button in the lower left hand corner, and there's a menu that comes up with the shutdown option. And that's the one I use. It's the most bland of them all, but that's my favorite. That's just the one I'm used to. So you find what you're going to be used to. You can use any of those different options. But again, there might be more ways to do it. Those are the three that, you know, that I'm aware of and that, you know, I've shown people how to do.
What about this button here?
Which button there? That's the button to turn your system on. I wouldn't recommend holding that down to turn the system off, because you're not going to do a proper shutoff for Windows. It might not go through its formal kosher shutoff process. You want to start the shutdown process in the software for yourself. You'll ensure that Windows can save everything that needs to save, shut down properly, and you won't cause any damage to the machine. Okay?
So let's touch on OneDrive really quickly. I'm not going to spend too much time on it. I did two classes this year, 2 hours worth of OneDrive. We showed off how this all this functionality works. But again, I mentioned that OneDrive is now baked into our Windows experience, and it's going to be even more so when Windows 10 hits the scene next year. But it's really neat so far already because, for example, I'm signed into my OneDrive account. You're going to ask, well, how do I sign into my, or my Microsoft account, I should say. I just keep calling it a OneDrive account. I'm slipping here. But it's really called a Microsoft account, right? If you have an Outlook.com address, or you've signed up for OneDrive, or if you signed up for Hotmail in the past, you have now what's called a single unified Microsoft account. And that entitles you to for OneDrive storage, which is your cloud storage if you want to use it. It's there for the taking. It's completely free. You don't have to pay a dime for it. There's no reason not to use it. And if you're using Windows 8, you really should be signing in and using a Microsoft account. If you don't know whether or not you're signed in with a Microsoft account or not, you can go into your charms bar, go into settings, change PC settings. Actually, let me, this color is too harsh. Turn it down. Let's make it look purple here. So let me go back into my charms bar, settings. I'm going to go into change PC settings. And again, you have to go through this through the start screen. This is one option to sign into your Microsoft account. You can't do it from your traditional control panel area. So this is one item. You have to make sure you're doing the charms bar from the start screen. Now I have an option that says accounts here, and I'm signed into my Microsoft account. My dloader is outlook.com Microsoft account. So it's asking me to disconnect, but if I wasn't signed in, it would give me an option here to sign myself into a Microsoft account. So what that means is instead of using an account that's just tied to the computer, that sits on that computer only, I am tied into my cloud account. And the nice part about that is, not only do I get to save my items into my OneDrive area and travels and synchronizes up to my cloud from Microsoft, but it also synchronizes my apps I have installed. So here's the nice part. If I install apps on this computer that I'm using Windows 8 on, and I send into this Microsoft account on my Windows tablet that I have Windows 8 on, it automatically installs all those same programs and apps that I have on here on the other machine. I go to work, I can sign into my Microsoft account on there, carries all those settings and all those apps to the other machine as well. So that cross-device experience becomes easier and easier if you're using your Microsoft account. If you're not using a Microsoft account, you don't get that nice, seamless cross-device experience. So let's see, you're using a Microsoft account, actually. You're using a Microsoft account that's just tied to your personal email. That's not a Microsoft email. But you already have the functionality because you signed yourself in. So you should be able to do everything I'm showing here on the screen. So what's nice about this, and what I'm going to show off here, so if you're curious why should I care about using OneDrive, here's why you should care. Here's what's so cool about this. I can save anything. This is my OneDrive area on my computer here. And again, someone was asking about Windows Explorer. This is Windows Explorer, as we know and love it, right? So I have an area called OneDrive here, as you can see. And I have all these different folders that I've made. I pretty much keep my data history, all my history that I used to keep on flash drives or external hard drives, they keep it all within my OneDrive because I know it's in one place and always backed up for me. So for example, all these items are accessible on my computer. My Windows 8 class, I prepared all my documents for today in this folder. And that item is also accessible. If I go on the web and I sign into my OneDrive account from there, and this is the same thing that I have on my computer. So as you can see, all my folders that I have here are the same folders I have on my online OneDrive account. So I can edit these files on the web now. I can synchronize them to my different devices. I use my Windows phone and I can access items right off of there very seamlessly. So again, it's taking that experience of just keeping things on your computer and hoping and praying that your computer doesn't crash to an experience that says, you know what, OneDrive backs those things up for me. I don't have to worry about losing those items because as long as it's in my OneDrive folder, it's safe, it's always accessible, and I really don't care if I lose my laptop because everything's saved in my OneDrive account. Right? So this is the power of that OneDrive cloud that really starts to come to fruition. If I go in my Windows 8 class folder, you'll see I have all the same items that I have here.
If this computer crashes or dies, I sign into Windows 8 from another computer, I sign myself in, all those files start downloading automatically, and it's as if nothing ever happened. I mean, that is nice. That is seamless, you know, easy computing, you know, worry-free computing, you know, whereas we were always worried about backups and backups and backups. Microsoft says, stop worrying, use your OneDrive account, we'll handle the backups for you. Check if you're signed into a Microsoft account, and then if you want files to be saved into OneDrive in this sort of fashion, you have to make sure they're being saved within this OneDrive folder on your computer, right? If you're not saving them into the OneDrive area, they're not being synchronized up. Things you leave on your desktop are not being synchronized to OneDrive. Things you put in the root of your C drive are not going into OneDrive. So you really have to make a conscious effort to put them into OneDrive, right? A little bit more extra effort on your side, but it's also nice because a lot of people are so concerned. I might not want that text document up on OneDrive. It's not going to be there by default. You have to make the effort to put it there. Once you do, then you'll get the functionality I'm showing you here with the synchronization. Sure. Oh, sure. So I go into my start screen. I go into my charms bar off my start screen. Mouse in the bottom right-hand corner. Click on settings, and if I go into change PC settings, yeah, now I'll have an option here that's called accounts, and if you're signed into with an email address, if you have an email address showing up here, you probably already are signed into a Microsoft account. If you're not, it's going to beat you over the head right here and say, use a Microsoft account or sign into a Microsoft account or create a Microsoft account. I forget what the exact context is, but it will tell you right away up here. Oh, sure. So again, when you're signed into OneDrive, your OneDrive is accessible off of your computer, right? There is a OneDrive folder that gets created in your computer, and you can make folders underneath there. So that's the local computer side that gets created, and you can put things in there. You can drag and drop pictures and music and other stuff that sits on your computer.
Okay, so you're going within the OneDrive app. I'm doing it within off the desktop interface. So go into your... Yeah. So she was going within the OneDrive modern app. I'm doing it within the more traditional Windows experience because this is probably where people have all their files sitting.
So what I did is instead of hitting the OneDrive icon over here, this one here, don't hit that. You can use that once you start putting all your files into it, but it's not very useful if you have nothing there to look at, right? So what I did... is I went to my desktop and I went into my computer icon or my Windows Explorer, as some people call it, and here is where I can easily see my OneDrive area. Mine's different because I have folders there already. You'll probably just have a thing called OneDrive.
Okay,
I'm gonna have Erica, can you show her how to get in there really quick? You're still going into the... Add a folder is very simple. If I go into my OneDrive, make sure I'm within there, I can right-click on my white space, new, folder, test folder. So if I make that folder here and I go into my online account for OneDrive, my test folder should show up in just any moment now. And there it is. Test folder just showed up on my web interface. So synchronization is happening as we speak here. No pre-canned demo of any sort. You can see it was made at 11:35 a.m. and it's got nothing inside of it. And it goes both ways. I can put stuff into my OneDrive account off my computer and it'll upload to the web, or I can go the other way. I can go into my web interface on OneDrive.com, dump it in from here, and it'll pass back down to my computer. It's a multi-way process. I can do it from my phone to my OneDrive and it goes to my computer. From my computer into my OneDrive and it hits my phone if I'm signed into OneDrive. It's, again, it's that multi-device experience, and if you come to the OneDrive class or you view it on our YouTube channel, you'll get the whole feel for how that whole experience works. I'm not going to dive too much further into it today. Okay? Everyone gets 15 gigabytes of free storage. You're going to be upping it even more, I'm hearing, as well. So there's going to be a point where you won't even have to worry about storage space. You'll be able to toss everything up into your OneDrive and just be able to store everything within there. So for now, there is a size cap of 15 gigabytes. That everyone gets, but at some point that limit is going to be getting higher and higher where you really won't have to worry. You can purchase more storage space.
I've got 50 gigabytes available on my account through certain promotions that I've gotten. You might have more accessible to you, but again, 15 gigabytes is the default that everyone gets for their OneDrive. Totally free. Pictures can go there, music can go there, whatever you want to put in there can go there. You would not have to do this. But, you know, there are a lot of backup routines that people do, like thumb drives and things. I would say this is a lot safer than doing a thumb drive or an external hard drive, right? Those kind of things have a lot of moving parts, a lot of things that can fail. This is as seamless as it gets. This really is the easiest form of backup that you could do. Put it in your OneDrive. So I would recommend doing this. I don't do backups like that necessarily anymore. I let OneDrive do all the heavy lifting for me. It doesn't cost me a dime. Okay? All right, let's keep moving here. A few things about the traditional desktop. I want to leave a few little bit of time for questions here. I am in my traditional desktop experience here. How do I get to my desktop? If you haven't seen me do it already, your desktop tile is just a little tile that you can click on, right? By default, it might be a little smaller. It might be something like that, or just a little bit larger like that. It's called desktop. I made it a little bit bigger since I go into it very often. I made it large. But it's just a tile. It's a tile on your start screen. You get to it right from there. You can. Once you go into it once, then you can use your Windows key and your keyboard to go back and forth between them. So that's the way that I like doing it because it's so easy. Because I'm in front of a keyboard almost all day, you know, when I'm working. So it's easy for me. But again, the same thing by hitting the Charms Bar Windows button, hitting the little Windows button on the bottom left-hand corner of your taskbar. A lot of different ways to get back and forth between these screens. So traditional desktop. Not that much to say about it. It's still there. This is still where you can use your full-blown, your traditional Google Chrome if you need to, your regular Internet Explorer if you need to. You've got access to your Windows Explorer, your My Computer, as they called it in Windows XP and Windows 7. It's still there. It's still accessible. And I can get to all my files if I need to. So nothing in that regard has really changed. To get into the little... Yeah, I go into this PC. Some people only have a little icon on the bottom left-hand corner. So I know it's a little hard to see. Let's see if I can zoom in on it. There's a little icon. The chair is blocking a little bit. But there's an icon on the bottom left-hand corner that looks like a file folder called File Explorer. And I can go in there, and that's the same thing as going through this computer. Or my computer. If I plug in my flash drive, it'll show here. If I plug in any kind of other external drive, it'll show here. So this is the way that you can manage and get between those devices, just like we used to do in the old versions of Windows for ourselves. Our left-hand navigation experience is still present. All my folders still show up on the left-hand side. I can go between them in that tree-style navigation that a lot of people like, that I still like to use as well. tabbed interface, I'm almost drawing a blank. I don't think Windows 7 uses this. No, Windows 7 doesn't use this. I've been on Windows 8 too long. I'm forgetting what Windows 7 has. But Windows 8 brings over those same concepts in Windows Explorer that we have in the new Office, right? So that ribbon style experience that we're used to in Office now applies to our Windows Explorer view. Microsoft's brought those same concepts into here. And the same concept applies if I go into things like Paint. If I go into WordPad, right, same kind of tabbed experience exists. So that same ribbon style interface is now applying across the board to many different aspects of how Windows does things. So if you learned Office 2007 and you got used to the ribbon interface, you'll be right at home with how Windows changed all the things and moved it from long drawn out menus to simple ribbons that move things into a contextual common category area for ourselves. Okay? You can go ahead and you can pin a few different items on your quick access toolbar on Windows Explorer. So on the upper part of Windows Explorer, if you open it up, this My Computer, as we used to call it, you can add on different functions up here, just like you can do in Office. Again, that same concept applies. Undo, redo, delete files, rename files, those quick little areas, quick little options that we have in Office. Now we can bring those into our Windows Explorer. Okay. Yeah, you can do a search right within here. In terms of searching within this area here, on this screen here, oh, I can get to that no matter where I am. No matter where I am, I hit my Windows key on my keyboard, and I can start typing no matter what I'm doing. No matter how many apps I've opened, no matter if I'm within modern or different or legacy apps, go back to your start screen, start typing, and the search function, the first search function works right. Okay? So back to our traditional desktop interface for ourselves. So I showed off some of the aspects of the Windows Explorer, not too much to show there for us. Jump lists used to be around in Windows 7. They started in Windows 7. If you have taskbar shortcuts for yourself, I'll zoom in here on my taskbar. For example, like Word, if I right-click on my Word icon in my taskbar, I can bring up all my different recently used documents. So someone was asking about some of those documents, right? Recently used documents. I use my jump lists for that most of the time, especially for my Office documents, and that changes based upon what shortcut it is. If you're curious how to make a shortcut on your taskbar, I can make that for any legacy app right off of my full screen. If I search for an app, for example, if I didn't have a shortcut to PowerPoint, I could search for PowerPoint, I can right click on it, and I can do pin to taskbar. Pin the taskbar, if I go back to my regular legacy desktop interface, we'll now have an icon for PowerPoint right at the bottom over here. So that's how I can pin things down to my taskbar, if that's how you like to work. I have a few things I pin to my taskbar. I don't pin everything to my taskbar, but a few things that I do like to have for there since I'm working within here so often. Now, I know there are some of you that want to use desktop shortcuts still. I still haven't gotten out of the habit either. A lot of people still do it though. If you want to make a desktop shortcut for something and it's not already on your desktop, let's go back. We'll do a search for it. So for example, if I wanted to make an Excel shortcut on my desktop, start typing for Excel, right click on that shortcut in the search area, go to open file location. I know it sounds weird, but this is how you have to do it. You'll bring up the area now where the shortcuts are hiding behind the scenes. And now I can drag and drop a shortcut for Access or anything else. Copy. Make a shortcut for OneNote. Copy. So that's how you can make traditional shortcuts on your desktop. So that is the only way that you can do it. Okay? So if you're a desktop icon kind of person, even though I hate cluttered desktops and a lot of icons, you can still do it if you really, really want to. It still exists. But it's a little bit harder because Microsoft's trying to get us out of the habit being messy with these desktop shortcuts. Okay?
I have a shortcut on there. I can click on it.
You can pin it to your taskbar instead. You can right click on it, and you should be able to pin it. Some things you can pin to your taskbar, not everything. It depends on what it is that you're trying to do. A lot of them, if you right click on it, you should be able to have an option that says pin to taskbar. You see how this one has pin to taskbar? I could pin that to my taskbar. I could have Erica take a look at it. I'm not exactly sure. It might just, the app might not offer it, or it might just be a different context. Most apps should give you the option to pin that right to the taskbar. I'm going to bring up the task manager really quickly. Control-Alt-Delete, three-finger salute. If you've heard of that, that is the old task manager that we're used to. If you do that now in Windows 8, it brings up the menu that gives you a few more options, and then from here we can click on Task Manager. By default, you're going to get something that looks just like this. So if you're used to before people saying go in your Task Manager and close out of that app that's frozen, you don't have to know that technical name for the app. Microsoft made it simple now. All apps that you're running have a very simple proper name for it, and I can close out of it if it's frozen or not working properly right from here. Maps is frozen, I can click on it and do end task. So this is more that little traditional way that we used to close out things that used to freeze back in the older days of Windows. If you're used to that fuller experience and you like that full-blown task manager like I do because I'm so geeky, you can do more details and it'll bring up all kinds of cool stuff. You can see how much memory you're using and internet bandwidth that you're using, the history of how much time and bandwidth and updates that your apps have used over a time span. All kinds of different options you have here. Be careful on some of these. Some of these things you don't want to touch. You can do some damage, especially in your startup area, if you take things out that have to be starting with your computer. So be careful. But if you know what you're doing, you can go in here and you can get very, very behind the scenes if that's your kind of thing. Okay? So the task manager now has two different views. Simple view for most of us. More details view for the geeky people that like to get down and dirty. Okay? If you want to get into the traditional control panel, you can do it in one of two ways. I can go into my charms bar off the start screen, go into my settings gear, and I can click on control panel, and that'll bring up my traditional control panel. All of my different items that we all know and love that used to be there before, they're all still here for the most part. There's a few things I put on the agenda that I wanted to, was going to show off. The few that I really want to make mention of, if you've got kids in the home, there's family safety now available in Windows 8. Never before has parental control been so nice on here. I can restrict what programs kids can use at what times, what different user accounts can use those different apps at those times. If I don't want Johnny playing World of Warcraft after 8 o'clock, I can restrict that in here. If I don't want my kids going on certain websites, I can restrict that in here as well. I used to always tell people that you needed something like NetNanny to get this done. Windows 8 now bakes that all in by default, so you have that same kind of functionality for the most part. So very, very powerful. Family safety actually lives up to its name for the first time in Windows 8. There is an option in here that you can use called storage spaces. If you want to get creative and you need to have a lot of space to use for files, you can create a large storage pool out of like three external hard drives. If you have three different 2 terabyte hard drives, you can make a large 6 terabyte drive for that, and you can store files on that, and that's via storage spaces. I usually reserve that more for the people that are a little more technically inclined, but I have, you know, seen people online that have combined USB flash drives as one big storage area, so you can combine those now and make storage spaces out of them. Windows Mobility Center, if you go into Windows Mobility Center, this is sort of a one-stop shop for the laptop or tablet users. You have all those common options, your display brightness, your sound volume, your battery options, your power options, whether or not you're presenting, you can turn your presentation mode on and off. So again, if you don't know the little shortcuts on your keyboard to access all these, if you haven't done it before, Windows Mobility Center makes it easy because it brings it all into one single interface for you. Okay? And Windows updates, this used to be around, of course, in Windows XP and Windows 7. It's been done better than it's ever done before because now we don't have to set up what time we want Windows to update. So before, remember, Windows always wanted to update at 3 a.m. A lot of us don't leave our machines on at 3 a.m. It's kind of a stupid option to make it at 3 a.m. Now Windows 8 is smart enough to say, okay, if you want me to go ahead and check for updates or install them automatically, it will adjust itself to know that when you have some downtime when the system is on, to check for them and do that all behind the scenes without having to be set to a strict schedule like it used to be in the past. So it's very smart, very intelligent. For the most part, it works very, very well. And this is how, you know, you get your PC, your security updates, your patches and things like that. Come right through Windows Update. If you have updates waiting for you when you sign into your computer, it'll tell you. You have 10 updates waiting to be installed. And you can click on that right from your lock screen once you sign in, and you can go right in and install those updates if they didn't happen automatically. I'm someone that likes to comb through and check all the updates before I install them. I'm very particular like that, but for most people, leave the default options on just to have all those things installed right away for you right behind the scenes. Okay? A few shortcuts to remember for Windows 8. Some of the common ones, I put them right on the back of the agenda. You can take a look at them there. There are probably more that you'll run into that I didn't put on here. Alt plus tab is very nice. I can go into any of my different open items very easily. I can just hold down my alt tab and keep scrolling through all the different items that I have open. So it's a very simple way to get between a lot of different screens if you have a lot of things open. Very simple to, you know, view those things and just go between them very easily like that. So that's Alt plus Tab. the Windows key plus X, actually, you really don't have to do this anymore. This used to be in the older Windows 8, non-Windows 8.1. There's a secret menu that you can get to. I do it now by just right-clicking.
This darn chair is a menu. Let's move this over. So this little Windows button in the bottom left-hand corner for the power users, if you right-click on that,
it actually brings up a little secret menu where you can do a lot of common functions. You can get into programs and features. You can get into your event viewer, your system area, your disk management, your computer management, your control panel. So for those of you that are a little more on the geeky side, that's the menu that you can use. You can shut your computer down from there. And again, you can get there by right-clicking on that start button or by just hitting Windows key plus X. So that's two different ways you can get into that. All the way in the bottom left corner of your screen, off the desktop. It's a start button now that just brings you back into your start screen, but in Windows 10, it's actually gonna have a start menu that comes back in a different form, okay? Another shortcut is just, I've been talking about it all class, Windows scan your keyboard, tap it to go back and forth between your different interfaces, traditional, modern, back to traditional. Okay, that's the one I use probably 30, 40 times a day, maybe more. It's the old common button I'm using all day, so it's very easy to go back and forth between your modern screen and your desktop, your traditional desktop screen. And the last one I put on there was the start button right-click. I just talked about that as well. That's the same menu, that hidden menu that you can get to do things. I'm within this menu a lot. I get to almost everything I need to get to right from here. Again, I'm a geeky, old-school IT kind of person, so this makes sense to me. But again, it's just an option for those that, you know, may want to use that for themselves. And for those of you that just can't live without the old start menu from Windows 7, there are programs that can bring that functionality back. The one that I tell people about if they really need it is called Start Menu 8. I put it on the back of the agenda. If you just Google Start Menu 8, it is a free program made by IOBit, and all it does is bring back the old start menu. Okay, so if you're someone that just can't live without it, you can put it on. I've got some customers that don't want to learn the new Windows 8 or are uncomfortable with it, and they put this back on for themselves. Again, you won't need it for too much longer since the start menu is coming back in Windows 10. But for now, if you can't live without it, download Start Menu 8, and you can relive the glory days of Windows 7 for yourself. So it's there and available for you if you really want to use it. Okay? Nothing will bring back XP. Thank God. So that's something that won't be brought back. That's it in terms of my formal content. We have a little bit of time here. I wanted to open up some of the time for questions. So I guess we'll get right to it. It's about 11:54. I want to open at least 5 minutes or so to questions. And I'll definitely stay a little bit longer if questions do go along. It's called NOD32. It's the program that we use on all of our customer machines. It runs $40 for 1 year, $60 for 2 year subscription. It is pretty much all we use internally and on customer systems. It's called NOD32. It's on the back of our agenda. Since everyone asks us what we recommend for antivirus, I put it on almost every agenda that we put out now. We're right in Park Ridge. We're just northwest of the Northwest Highway and Potter intersection. So if you know where Main East is, just west of Main East. You can choose to write out Norton and then get this one, or you can uninstall Norton and then put that one up, but you don't want to write it. It'll be
on the other side.
Any other questions about Windows 8, the new stuff that we learned here today? Anything that I went over? Split screen, modern apps, Windows Store, charge bar? A lot of terms I've been flying around here.
Did you say you were at the Park Ridge Library just the second Saturday?
Second Saturday of every month. Park Ridge Library from 9 afternoon on the third floor. Whatever light tech questions you have, you can bring them there, and we're there for your disposal. I'm going to have Erica take a look at your machine with you. I'm going to make sure I answer everyone else's questions. Anything else Windows 8 specific that needs to be told to the group? If you have a personal question for me and my staff, you can wait till we finish the recording, we finish class. No questions. I must have done a really good job.
You did. You did.
Go ahead, sir. Not be an automatic change. I'm not exactly sure how the upgrade process will work. It's probably going to be a download you'll have to do, but it'll be fairly seamless in terms of making that transition. The goal is to make it as easy as possible, and it's I don't know the exact process, but it's going to be fairly easy. Okay? But as far as I'm hearing, everyone running Windows 8 will get a free upgrade to Windows 10. So, yes?
How long is Windows 7?
Windows 7 will be supported until about 2018 or 2020 or so. It's still going to be on the market. It's still going to be, we'll have updates released for it. It's not going away, but it's going to be fading into history, in the next 4, 5, 6 years. So, you don't necessarily have to make the switch now, but on your next PC purchase, you're going to probably be facing a Windows 8 or a Windows 10 system at that point. So it's around the corner. Go ahead.
On the backup to OneDrive.
Yes.
I'm accessing OneDrive now when I'm working on my documents.
Okay.
Will it then periodically when I log into OneDrive, it'll just pick up the backup at that time, or how does that?
It will go ahead. Yeah, good question. When you save files into your OneDrive here and your computer, you can be off the internet when you do that. Traveling on the train, going on a plane, whatever you may be doing. When you hit the internet the next time, it'll go ahead and recognize you're on the internet, and it'll synchronize the changes then.
Okay.
You don't have to be online at all times to be able to use the OneDrive capabilities.
Right, but as far as the backup portion of that,
sure.
That will do the same?
That's the process I'm talking about, the synchronization.
Oh, okay, so anytime I log in for any reason.
The synchronization is in terms of the backup as well. It's a two-in-one concept.
Right.
If you didn't put your raffle ticket in and you want to win one of two goodie bags, make sure you don't forget. And don't leave early. We have people win and leave early, so shame on you. What's up? Our address, our address, we're at 1480. 1480 Renaissance Drive. Suite 102. Thank you so much. I really appreciate everyone coming on by. Does anyone have any other questions? I want to make sure I capture them in the recording. If anyone has any final questions specifically for myself or Steph, you can feel free to ask us. I'm going to stop the recording now, and Lindsay will go ahead and we'll pull for goodie bags right now.
Driving around and having no cell phone.